Okay, Be'ezat Hashem, Na'aseh V'Natzliach. I want to welcome you to Ironside Lunch and Learn as we continue to do our study of the weekly Parsha portion. Before we get started on Parashat Beshalach, I'd like to give an honorable mention to Ofer Mizrahi for allowing us for the use of the space. Always got to have Hakarat Tov to that gentleman, for Judah Mendel, for putting this together for many, many years already. Shtabach Shemolad, because of you, we are here every single day. It's to your merit. I also want to give an honorable mention to our sponsors. Our sponsors are Hummus Factory, that every single week they've committed themselves to give us a beautiful, healthy lunch. Truly grateful for that. The food is delicious. The place is great. If you have a chance, visit that establishment. And today we have an extra special add-on. We have the Jewish National Foundation, the JNF, who is it the fund or foundation?
Fund.
I'm sorry, Jewish National Fund, who jumped in today and added some more goodies to the table. So be'emet, Sodat Ki Yad HaMelech over here, healthy, good, delicious. I want to thank you, Jeffrey, for putting it together, for being a part of it. And I want to thank you guys for stopping your day in the middle of the day and coming to learn Torah. They say anyone who can stop his work day, which is the milchama, this is the war. You're fighting for parnasa, and you're coming here to learn divrei Torah. That's a person with emunah. Why? Because parnasa is mishamayim, and we're going to learn that in this week's lesson. That whatever is coming to you is coming to you. You have to have that emunah, and that's anyone that he can pull himself away from his work to go pray mincha or to go listen to a Torah lesson in the middle of work. It's a big, big segula.
Still need istadlut.
That nothing works without ishtadlut. You can't sit on the couch and say, Hashem, look, I go to Torah classes during the day, give me my money. You have to go do your utmost. And after you do your utmost, Hashem says, okay, I'll take it from here. Let's get started. So thank you to all of you. Also, I'd like to dedicate this lesson to the Ilu Nishmai of Fortuna Bat Esther, Shulamit Batrina, Yosef Ben Hasiva, and Yosef Ben Allegra. Be'ezat Hashem, that these divrei Torah will be to the Ilu Nishmat, and to Hana Bat Chaya and the new baby girl of Michael Ben Melech, Be'ezat Hashem, that they have a healthy recovery and that everything will be B'sorot Tovot and a healthy baby, healthy mommy. And this should be to the Hatzacha of that family as well. Okay, let's get started. Parashat Beshalach is, again, one of those parashiyot that is packed with things that we could talk about. If it's Yetziat Mitzrayim, if it's the splitting of the sea, if it's the Jews in the desert, if it's the man, the Slav, Shirat Hayam, Az Yashir Moshe, Amalek coming to fight us at the end of the parasha. Pick any topic and we could go on for hours. Now, just so you understand where we are right now, we're right after the 10 plagues. Right after the Aseret HaMakot, and we get to the part of the splitting of the sea, the miracles that happened over there in Yetziat Mitzrayim and Kriyat Yam Suf. And as we begin to go into the story, we see that the Jews' belief in God is at an all-time high. In Hashem and His servant Moshe Rabbeinu. You took a slave nation and you turned them into a free nation with a magic show that like no other. All the Nisim Veniflaot that were done over there with the climax of a splitting of a sea. How can you not believe in Hashem and Moshe Rabbeinu? However, just shortly after that, just a short period of time after that, we see the decline of the Jew. They just climaxed. They just had such a great experience. This went from big emunah, meriting the Geula, Hashem revealing Himself to the Jewish people. It says over there in Az Yashir Moshe, Ze Eli Ve'Aromenu Elo Aviv. Ze Eli Ve'Anvehu Eloi Aviv Ve'Aromenu. They said they pointed to the heavens. The heavens split. They saw Hashem. They saw the Merkava. Just a few days later, the Jews begin to complain. And it starts like this. In Perek Tedvav, Pasuk Chavdalet, it says, Vayalonu ha'am al Moshe le'emor, ma nishteh? They were thirsty. They come and complain to Moshe Rabbeinu, we are thirsty. ויצעק השם, ויצעק אל השם, ויורהו השם עץ. It says over there that Moshe screamed out to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Yitzak, meaning not yelling at God, pray to God. It's a type of prayer. You know, prayer, there's many different types of prayers. Tzaka is one of them. Vayorehu Hashem etz, and Hashem showed him a tree. Now, Vayishalech el amayim vayimatekeo, amayim sham sam lo chok, mishpat v'sham nisao. He says he took this tree, he threw it into the water, because they were in next to a body of water that had bitter waters. The waters became sweet, and over there, Sham Sam Lochok Umishpat Visham Nisahu. Over there he gave them laws, he gave them some rules, some guidelines, and over there he tried them, he tested them. So let's just park ourselves on this Pasuk for a few minutes. It says, now that the Jewish people came out of slavery, came out of being that mentality of a Jew, of a slave in Egypt. They're so used to, right before this, if we go to the Pasukim, I mean, I could read the entire parasha as a story, but I want to, you know, cut to the chase. They say, oh, we were so comfortable in Egypt. We used to sit on the pot. We used to smell the meat. We used to eat the bread. We used to have everything that we needed. As a slave, we were content. Wow. So now that they're now as a freed people, they almost don't know how to behave. They don't know how to act. Mm-hmm. They don't know even how to think. Keep in mind, we're right now witnessing the forming of a nation. You're beginning to see the beginning, the baby stages of Am Yisrael. And they say, what will be our sustenance? What will be our sustenance in this free life that we entered? They're starting to ask, where do we get water from? Before, we used to get it a certain way. Now, how do we get water? Vayareu Hashem etz. And Hashem told him, showed him a tree. He says, you know how you're going to get your sustenance? Through a tree. Which tree? Etz Chaim hi l'machzikim ba. What's Etz Chaim l'machzikim ba? The Torah. That's your spiritual sustenance. Over here, that's how you're going to get the nutrition that your neshama needs. Now, the pasuk, the end of the pasuk says, Sham sam lochok v'mishpat v'sham nisaho. Keep in mind, we're just on one pasuk. We have to sometimes analyze one pasuk to understand what's going on over here. Mm-hmm. So it says, Rashi says, what does it mean? Natan lo sham sam lo chok u'mishpat v'sham nisao. He says he gave them a few mitzvot. In other words, the etz chayim l'machzikim ba the Torah, you're going to get it soon. When? In Vav Sivan, Matan Torah, in Shavuot, 49-day process from Yetziat Mitzrayim. But before you get the Torah, busy yourself with this. Let me give you a sampling of the Torah. What's the sampling of the Torah? He gave them Shabbat, how to keep Shabbat. He gave them Para Aduma. And then he gave him Dinin, which means that he gave him a sprinkling, a buffet of rational, super rational mitzvot, some that make sense, some that don't make sense, and some monetary laws. The Chok is the super rational, which means what? Things that are beyond our understanding. Like the red heifer, Para Aduma. We don't understand. Take a red cow, burn it, take the ashes, spray it on somebody, he becomes holy. But the guy that sprinkled him becomes unholy. Can somebody explain me that? Shlomo HaMelech, the smartest man in the world, says, Rechokai mimeni. I don't know. I can figure out everything. I still don't get that one. Another one was the Pesach offering. Why do we do that? He said, we don't understand. That's a chok. Do it because you're told to. You don't need to understand it. Which, by the way, this is the hardest thing for the goyim to understand. Mm-hmm. They need something that makes sense.
Makes sense.
You see that guy? That's who I worship. You see what I do? It's because of this. They don't have chokim. Everything's got to make sense in order for them to accept it. We are the nation of Naaseh v'Nishma. Let me do it. Later on, give me an explanation. Yeah. I really don't need it. If you want to give it to me, great. Yeah. נעשה ונשמע is a mentality, it's a state of mind, it's the proposal that we did to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, you want to be my nation? After he went to every single nation, you want to be with me? Here's some Torah, here, this, can you steal? He went to the Ishmaelim, can you steal? You can't, no, I'm sorry, to Esav. You're not allowed to steal. Not allowed to steal, that's what I do, that's my business, I'm a thief. He goes to Ishmaelim, you can't murder. You can't murder, that's what I do, that's my business, I thirst blood. Mm-hmm. He comes to the Jewish people, they tell him, Na'aseh v'nishma, whatever you say. Whatever you want, we'll do. We'll listen to the reasoning after. So a chok comes from that mentality exactly. Mishpat is monetary laws. You know, it's parashat mishpatim, it's a parashah we read through in a couple of chapters. You should see the gemarot that are on Mishpatim. I'm currently, Baruch Hashem, learning Baba Kama that talks about the monetary laws, Arban Avot Nezikin, about the four fathers of monetary damages. Hashor, Habor, Hamaver, Vaever. Wow! You won't believe how deep, how the rabbis, I want to tell you, if you want to do mental gymnastics, if you want to see how the lawyers figured out how to do monetary laws, it all started from this parasha. From our Mishpatim and our Gemarot. It says, Visham Nisahu, meaning he gave him the Chok, Parah Aduma, and Korban Pesach. Mishpatim, the monetary laws. Visham Nisahu, he says, I'm going to test them with one other mitzvah. Which one was it? Shabbat and the man. What's Shabbat? Shabbat, he's introducing them. You work 6 days, you rest on the seventh. And during this time while you're going to be here in the desert, I'm going to rain on you the man. What's the man? The heavenly manna, but bread from the heavens. And what are you supposed to do? You take enough for what you need, and so it lasts you for 2 days. On Shabbat, you don't go and collect. That was the test. Which, by the way, they failed. Sham Nisahu, he said, I'm going to test you. And he told them what the test will be, and they failed. Let's continue. In Pasuk Tedvav, in Perk Tedvav, Pasuk Chavav, he says, this is the disclaimer to the Jewish people. He says, Vayomer, this is God speaking. I'm sorry, this is Moshe speaking. It's Hashem speaking. He said, Vayomer, Moshe speaking. Vayomer, Im Shamua Tishma Lekol Hashem Elokecha, Vayashar Be'enav Ta'aseh, והאזנת למצוותיו ושמעת כל חוקיו. Here's the guarantee. כל המחלה אשר שמתי במצרים לא אשים עליך כי אני השם רופאיך. Let's stop on this pasuk also. First of all, the literal translation says, if you are going to heed, if you're going to listen to the voice of Hashem, in other words, to all the rules and mitzvot, asem mitzvot la ta'aseh, that he gave to you, ve'hayashar ve'enav ta'aseh, and you walk the straight and narrow, you do the right thing by him, ve'ezanta le'mitzvotav, and you listen to the mitzvot, ve'shamata kol chukav, and you were able to keep all the chukim. Remember, we were talking about the chukim. Those are the super rational mitzvot that don't make hard for us to understand. And we get a guarantee. Now you have to understand there is these formulas. Right now I'm building a formula. A plus B equals C. I'm going to show it to you. It says, what's the result of all that? Kol ha-machala she-samti b'mitzrayim, all the sicknesses, all the diseases, or all the makot that I put in Mitzrayim, lo asim alecha, I will not put on you, the Jewish people, ki ani Hashem rofecha.
There's so much other than...
There's more than what he said.
No.
Kol ha-machala, all the machalot.
This shahadid to the Mitzrayim, you only put 10 of them. What about this million other ones?
Kol ha-machala.
I think you should say I
will
take care of all the
machala,
period. Not only
exactly,
the one I gave to Mitzrayim.
Exactly.
Right?
Because I am God, I am your doctor. So you have to understand. A plus B equals C. In other words, if you listen and you keep the mitzvot, if you listen, A, and you keep the mitzvot, the guarantee is... you're not going to get any of the machalot. You're not going to get any of the diseases that are ever I'm going to protect you. Why? He tells you why. And sometimes Hashem doesn't have to give a reason. He says, you know why? Because understand this. Ki ani Hashem rofecha. I am your doctor. I am your healer. I am the one that can give you the Yeshua. That's why. So now remember that, because this running theme is going to go throughout the entire lesson. In Perek Tet Zayin, in Pasuk Bet comes, the complaining continues. Vayolonu kol adat bnei Yisrael Moshe va'aron bamidbar. Here we go. Vayolonu. Vayomru anei bnei Yisrael mi yiten moten biyad Hashem b'etzimtzumam bishivtenu asir basar b'ochelnu lechem lasova ki hotzetem otanu l'amidbar hazeh la'amit et kol hakahal hazeh b'ra'av. It says, now their second complaint is, oh, we were so good. Yashavnu al asir b'mitzrayim. Look what they were yearning for. They didn't say she'achlu me'asir, that they ate from the pot. The Egyptians, you know what? They would let them sit next to the big pot of meat. They would just smell it. Just to smell. Yashvim al asir. And they would eat the bread and that would give them some sort of satisfaction. So they went over here. And they're complaining on that. And said, "Ba'chanu lechem nasova." We would smell the pot, but we would eat the bread to bring us to this midbar to kill us with starvation. And over there, Hashem says, "Okay, I get it. They're hungry. They're hungry." What does he do? If we read pasuk gimel and pasuk dalet. He goes, ויאמר השם משה, הנני ממטיר לכם לחם מן השמיים, ויצא העם ולקטו דבר יום ביומו, למען אנסנו, הילך בתורתי, אם לא. Another disclaimer. He says, Hashem tells Moshe, you know what? No problem. I am going to rain from the heavens, angel food, man, angelic food, that once it goes into the body, could be any flavor. And by the way, it creates no excrement. They never had to go into the bathroom over there. Huh. That's a type of food that angels ate. Lechem abirim was called. But he says, v'laktu dvayom beyomo lemam dvayom beyomo. In other words, he started to teach them. You take just what you need. Just what you need for that day. Another life lesson. You know how we are. Sometimes we just, we start stocking up. On businesses, we start stocking up on money, we start stocking up on food, we start stocking up. Why? Because we don't know if we're going to have tomorrow. Hashem tells you, Yom Beyomo, every day I'm going to give you exactly what you need. But here in particular about the man, and he says, why am I going to do that? They're asking for food, I'm going to give them food, but I want them to pick just what they need one by one. Why? It's an emunah building process. You have to believe that tomorrow, Hashem is giving you what you need. If today you're taking double, what happens? You don't believe that tomorrow there's more food. This was an emunah building exercise. If you are going to take just what you need today, and tomorrow, Hashem yirachem. Hashem will provide. I know that. Once you get to that mentality, what does it say? Leman anesenu hayelech betuati imlo. Because I'm going to try him. Is he going to go according to my Torah or no? Disclaimer right there. Hashem says, every day I'm going to try you. Every day I'm going to try you. One day I'm going to come like this. One day I'm going to come like that. One day I'm going to come with the wife. One day I'm going to come with the business. One day I'm going to come with the health. One day I'm going to come with the finances. One day I'm going to come with a friend. One day I'm going to come with a stranger. Every day I'm going to try you to see if every single challenge that you have is going to be Hayelech betorati imlo. Are you going to take all your decisions in your life according to the Torah or otherwise? Now, if we continue to Perek Tetzayin, Pesuk Yud Bet, understand, I have to take you to this Pesukim so you can get the journey, so you can see how what we're leading up to. In Perek Tetzayin, Pesuk Yud Bet, it says, שמעתי תלונות בני ישראל, וידבר השם משה לאמור, השם says, שמעתי תלונות בני ישראל, דבר עליהם, tell them, לאמור, בין הערביים תאכלו בשר, ובבוקר תשבעו לחם, ודעתם כי אני השם אלוקיכם. No problem. You want water, you want bread, you want meat. We know that the meat that they had was the slav. A slav is like a quail bird that they had. And he says, show them that who can set up a full table in the desert. What's in the desert? You look left, sand. You look to the right, sand. You look up, you look down, everywhere you look, sand, sand, sand. Who can provide a full table with all the delicacies, anything that you want to eat in the desert? Hashem says, only Hashem. Here, Whatever you want to eat, you get it. Whatever you want to drink, you get it. The mayim would taste like anything you want to drink it. You want to taste like Coke, you want to taste like juice, it would taste like that. The mayim would taste like anything. The slav, they said that they couldn't get enough, it would be stuck in their teeth.
We say, look at Amazon.
What do we say? There's no shortage.
Now, giving him all these things and the people still didn't believe in God, I don't understand.
I wouldn't say believe in God.
I mean, they're not even...
There's something happening over here. They complain, they get what they want. They complain, they get what they want.
That's how we learn.
What happens? Now what happens? This brings us to the next pasuk. And for this, with this pasuk, we'll also learn a very famous Rashi. Something that you should know. This is a Rashi you should have under your belt that is very famous for the behavior of the Jewish people. If you go to pasuk Yud Zayin, pasuk Aleph, it says, "Vayisu kol adat bnei Yisrael mimidbar Sin lemaseihem al pi Hashem, vayechanu b'refidim ve'en mayim lishtot ha'am." So it says over here, after Hashem gave them the man, the slav, the water, they're right now traveling, all of Am Yisrael in the Sinai desert, and all in the instruction of a Kadosh Baruch Hu by the ways of the cloud, Amud Anan and Amud Shel Esh, and it says, Vayachanu b'refidim, and they rested in the refidim, ve'en mayim lishtot ha'am, and the nation did not have water to drink. Now, it says over here, in Pasuk Bet, that the Jewish people were in Refidim. Now you have to understand that these are places that were named because something happened there. It's not like there was a place called Refidim. It was named Refidim because at that point, after being in the desert, Rafu Yedehem Shel Am Yisrael, their hands became weak. What do we do with our hands? We work, right? Rafu Yedehem, in other words, their Avodat Hashem. Because what was them for to do? They weren't building buildings. They weren't doing work. The only work that they had was spiritual work, Hashem's work. Rafu Yedehem Avodah. They became lackadaisical in the Avodat Hashem. Hashem gave him a few mitzvot. Here, deal with this until I give you Matan Torah. And they became 3 days without not Shabbat, not Ilchot Shabbat, not anything that has to do, not Mishpatim. They didn't deal with it for 3 days. Rafu Yedehem, that's what that place was called, Refidim. And they said, En Mayim. That's the complaint, En Mayim. We know anywhere that you see the word Mayim, substituted for Torah. Mm-hmm. En Mayim El Torah. Lama Rafu Yadam? Why did their hands become weak? Why did they have lackadaisical service of HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Because en mayim. Because they didn't have Torah for 3 days. Now, what's the result of that? We go to Pasuk Chet, and it says, Vayavo Amalek Vayilachem Yisrael Birfidim. Amalek comes and says, this is where I'm going to win. I go to Refidim. They don't have any mitzvah to protect them. They have nothing. A mitzvah protects you. You should know that when you walk in the street, you know what protects you from a tree falling on your head? You know what protects you from, God forbid, getting into an accident? You know what protects you that you make a business deal? Because there's a mitzvah that's working. They have a protection. You know, how come dogs don't come and just bite us? Because they see that they have a special way to see, like especially dangerous animals, that you have letters on your head. Which letters? Letters that are formed according to the mitzvot that you have. And it scares off the animal. The mitzvot is your protection. As a matter of fact, sometimes if you want to train your children and they're walking the street and they're scared of a dog, you know what you tell them? Don't worry. Your mitzvot will protect you. Of course, you have to be there, you know, just in case that doesn't pan out. But that's the thing. That's a good thing to teach them, that their mitzvot are protecting them.
But you know, even the non-Jewish dog doesn't bite them.
You know? That's nowadays. But the Chachamim in the Gemara tell us that what protects us is the mitzvot. So here the pasuk goes, "Vayavo Amalek v'lachem Yisrael b'fidim." Amalek comes and attacks the Jews in this place called Rephidim. What's our reaction? And you should understand that you have to have a lot of guts. You have to have a lot of chutzpah as a nation, that the whole world knew that an entire nation got extracted from the most strongest dictatorship of the world, Paro. And the Makota were there. The whole world knew about this. And that the sea split. And that God is on the side of the Jews. And they say, you know what? Let's go find him. Oof. What a chutzpah. Rashi says, it's like when you have a boiling hot, a tub with boiling hot water. Boiling hot water. The first person jumping in is dead. But he still jumps in. You know why? He says, I'm going to jump in and I'm going to die. But you know why? Because I'm going to make it cooler for the next person. I'm going to make that hot bathtub or that hot pool cooler for the next. So more people jump in, more people jump in. So by the time the 100th person jumps in, it's not so boiling anymore. They said, let me cool the boiling hot tub for the nations to come. Amalek says, I know this is a kamikaze mission. I know that I'm going to die. But I'm going to make this that every single nation after me can come and attack the Jews, because they'll have no fear because Amalek did it. They opened up a pathway. Now, the pasuk that follows, what was the Jews' reaction? Pasuk Yudal says, "V'haya kasher yari Moshe yado v'gavar Yisrael v'kasher yaniach yado v'gavar Amalek." Moshe Rabbeinu says, "I can only do one thing. The biggest power that a Jew has, tefillah." He goes, Aaron, Yehoshua, each one on each side of him. He picks up his hands to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and he starts to pray, Hashem, help us, get us out of this mess, get us out of this problem. He prays to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and at that time, the Jews started to win the war. When his hands became tired, you know, the lactic acid buildup that you have on muscles, if you ever worked out, or if you ever kept your hands up for a long period of time, and there's something that builds up over here that doesn't let you keep up. And you put your hands down. When Moshe Rabbeinu's hands were down, the Jews would lose. So he would bring Yehoshua and Aharon to hold his hands up. Because as long as Moshe's hands are up in the air and they're praying, we're winning. When they're down, we're losing. Now, let's stop here. Amen. To understand the sequence of events and how they interlace together and what they mean to us today, we have to go back to the beginning. Before Hashem gave us the Torah, He gave us a tip. He gave us a tip for success. He says, almost like a cheat sheet to life, hey, before I give you the owner's manual to life, what do we, many times we mentioned, what's the Bible? It's basic instructions before leaving earth. He says, before I give you those that book that gives you all the answers on how to live as a successful Jew, let me give you a tip. Follow my laws, follow my mitzvot, follow my commandments, and anything that I did in Egypt, you just saw what could happen to somebody who's not going in Hashem's ways. You saw a prime example. You don't want to be the Egyptian, right? You want to be the Jew. So let me give you a tip how not to be like the Egyptian. He gave him several mitzvot, like we said. Chukot, Mishpatim, and the Nisayon of Shabbat and the Man. And the Jews were not successful in the performance of those mitzvot. Causing this formula of success to backfire. What's the opposite of success? Failure. So if you don't use the formula to success, it becomes a formula to failure. So instead of the mitzvot protecting you, you have Amalek that's coming to attack you. That's what was happening. So we see here a second formula. We see that when the Jews are marpim meyadam, or loosen their service of Hashem, they are vulnerable to attacks by their enemies. They are open to having damage happen to a Jew personally, collectively or as a nation, because they're naked of mitzvot. They have no mitzvot to protect them. In order to survive, what do? The minute that we see that the nations are coming upon us, the minute that we see that a community is suffering, the minute that we see that a person is not being successful in his life, we see that he doesn't have any Torah to protect him, any mitzvot to protect him, shirafu yadam, then what do with our hands? We pick them up. Just like Moshe Rabbeinu. We pick them up in our prayer to Hashem. Like Pasuk Yud Aleph said, והיה כאשר ירים משה ידו וגבר ישראל. We are Moshe. When we pick up our hands in prayer, what happened? גבר ישראל. We win. וכאשר יניח ידו, גבר עמלק. But when you're not praying, who wins? עמלק. Another formula. When you're praying to Hashem, you're winning. Or at least you have a chance to win, right? You're beginning the process of winning. When you're not praying, what happens? Default, you know, like there's a default setting. When you're not praying to Hashem, Amalek comes to you. Mm-hmm. Because it's like a cup. It's either you fill it up with a blessing. If there's no blessing, it's empty. What happens to it? The Tum'ah comes and takes over. Yeah. It's the same thing in Zivugim. Nachashim v'akavim babor. Says, well, it's the same thing in Zivugim. When a person is going out with a non-Jewish girl, what happens? His cup is taken up. His Zivug cup is full. If he doesn't take out the Goya and put a Jew, what happens? The place is void. So since there's no Kedusha, there's no Jewish girl filling up his Zivug cup, what happens? Nachashim v'akavim come inside, the Yetzer says, okay, fill it up with this. It's a default setting. So same thing over here. If we don't raise up our hands to Hashem, we're winning. When not, Amalek has the opportunity to come and attack. Now, what happens when you're marpe? What's marpe? When you start to, you know, when you leave it alone, when you leave the Torah alone, you need a rofe. You need a doctor. When you're marpe, ata tzarich rofe. When you start to let go of the mitzvot, what happens? All the bad things come upon a person, and then what happens? You need somebody to take you out of it. You need a doctor, you need a healer, you need someone who's going to give you your salvation, right? Okay.
I think sometimes these things also mean for the Olam Haba, not only for what happened right now, you know what I mean?
It's for all ages. It's for that moment, and for generations to come, for Olam Haba and ever and ever. The Torah is eternal.
No, because you know how to say sometimes Tzaddik, Baralo, Rasha,
Oh, we gave a big lesson on that. I can't get into it right now.
I'm saying these things might be
similar. That's a whole other subject. For what we're learning today, let's learn it this way.
Okay.
The Tzadik V'ra'alo V'rasha V'tovlo, we did several good lessons on it that give you the answer that you would be satisfied. Mm-hmm. I understand why things could be that way, and you don't have any more sfekot on Kadosh Baruch Hu. Be'ezrat Hashem, I'll share that class with you. Now, this is our lesson. When we're doing Torah, mitzvot, and ma'asim tovim, we get connected to Hashem, because we're not marpe. But when we don't, when we start to have that void, what happens? When our money doesn't work for us, when our attorney doesn't work for us, when our president doesn't work for us, when our friends can't help us, when our family can't help us, what happens when a guy tried all his cards? He has no more cards left. What happens to that Jew? Every Jew has a default setting. When he tried everything, religious or non-religious, when he tried every single option and it's not working out for him, every Jew does the same thing. Hashem, only you can help
me. Yeah.
Only you can help me. So what happens? Because you were marpe, you were lackadaisical in the service of Hashem, what do you happen? You turn to the rofe. Please help me out. It's a cycle. Now, it's a vicious cycle. Some people only turn to Hashem when they need something. They don't learn from that lesson that, okay, Hashem bailed you out, saved you out, okay, you're on the right track. They always, they become lackadaisical in their service, and then once again, they cry out. Now, even Paro knew this. In the beginning, in Parashat Shemot, in the fifth Perek, Pasuk Yud Zayin, it's something incredible. Paro was almost like being prophetic in what he was saying. Almost like a double language. when he saw that they wanted to go worship Hashem in the desert for a few days, what did he say? He says, "Vayomer, nirpim atem, nirpim." He says, you start to become, again, like lazy in your service, or lazy as a slave. Al ken atem omrim lecha nizbecha l'Hashem. That's why you're saying, I'm going to go and pray to Hashem. Because that's how the Jew acts. Mm-hmm. When he starts to be lackadaisical in Hashem and nothing works in Avodat Hashem and nothing works for him, what does he say? I have to go worship Hashem. Because he gets to that understanding, nothing else can help me except for God.
I think Hashem doing it sometimes purposely to somebody so he could come back to
us. I understand. Obviously, you know why? Because he's not doing it on his own.
Exactly.
He has to tap him on the shoulder.
Hey. Go like this, then he go back to the...
Exactly. Because he's tapping him on the shoulder. He says, hey, I'm going to let your finances go down. You know why? Because you're not talking to me. Maybe when you get to your last dollar, you say, Hashem, help me. Sometimes he gives us a health scare. Why? He's tapping on the shoulder. Hey, are you going to talk to me now? Because it's for your best. The more you talk to me, the more I can help you out, the more you can fulfill your final tikkun. Not necessarily what we need in this world. You know, we have eternal life. We have tikkunim. We have past lives. So he has to bring you to the point where you get to the tikkun, whether you understand it or not. The whole thing is to be connected to understand that. Now, when the Jews get to this part where they forget, Chazal tell us what happened. It was a 3-day process. They went 3 days without busying themselves with Torah and Amalek came. So what did our rabbis institute? They said, wait, let's learn a lesson from here. Chazal told us, knew that if a Jew doesn't have Torah in his life for a span of 3 days, he becomes vulnerable for attack. So in order to save him for attack, they instituted the Jews must get together every Monday, every Thursday, and every Shabbat to do what? To read the Torah. So you can't be without Torah for more than?
3 days.
3 days. They worried, da'agu, they worried that God forbid a Jew should be without Torah for 2 days. The Yetzirah comes and takes an attack, and after the third day, you start to become desensitized. You start to talk yourself out of it. He's already there. If you give him a chance of 3 days, that's it. It's very, very rough to come back out of it. That's what's very important to have Torah every day. Or at the most, no more than 3 days. The Ben Ish Chai says something unbelievable. He says, Yom Sheni, Yom Chamishi, Yom Shabbat is Yom Bet, Yom He, and Yom Zayin. Right? Those are the days of the week. He says, which days were left out? Dalet, Revi'i, Vav, Shishi, Aleph, Rishon, Gimel, Shlishi. If you take the days that were left out, you know what they spell out? Doeg. They were doeg that they're not going to be able to study Torah for 3 days, and that's what we have Monday, Thursday, and Shabbat.
Have nothing to do with prayer, right? I mean, you have to learn Torah. Nothing
yes.
to do with
doeg. What's doeg?
Doeg, worry. That they were worried. And all comes because it says, and they learn it from the pasuk that says, "Vayilchu sheloshet yamim b'midbar velo matzu mayim." They say, "Ah, they went 3 days velo matzu mayim, and they didn't have Torah." From this, they learn that we have to do get together Monday, Thursdays, and Shabbat. Now, if we go to pasuk tet vav, if we go to the pasuk, the first pasuk that we learn, it says, "Ve'ezan ve." They gave all the guarantees. Let's go back to that pasuk and now take two words. The literal meaning, and you listened to the mitzvot. However, if you know the dikduk of Hebrew, the word lehezanta could be also balance. You know, la'azen. Ve'ezanta le'mitzvotai. If you balanced yourself, if you balance your life with my mitzvot, that's the secret to success. Within that pasuk, we have another formula to the success. Which is it? Ve'ezanta le'mitzvotai. When you become balanced with my mitzvot, you can't be too extreme of nothing, and you can't be extreme without. You're in this world, you have to go to work. You have to make a living. You have to do all these things. You have to eat. You have to get married. You have to do all these different things. But he says, "Ve'ezanta le'mitzvotai."
Balance. That makes more sense than hearing.
Huh?
That makes more sense than just
when you read it like this.
With the hearing, like
yes.
Ve'ezanta makes more sense.
But however, you should know that the ears. How does a human being have equilibrium? It's in our ears. Yeah, in our ears are pockets of water. That according to their level is how a human being doesn't fall to the left, doesn't fall to the right. People that have vertigo, you know what they say, people that fall on their face, what happened? They don't have water in their ears. The water is not balanced. The reason why it's called ozen, because the ozen is ma'azin the ben adam. That's how you walk. Now, that's what gives you the balance. Now, what's the balanced life? The balanced life is living the mundane with spirituality. That's the secret of the Jew. That's how we know how to do it. We're not like the monks, the Buddhist monks, they go sit on a thing of spirituality. It doesn't work for us. Mm-hmm. And, or the other guy that's complete, no spirituality. We take both. We take half and half. That's what works for us. And it says, when you get that, Ve'ezanta mitzvotai, what's the guarantee? Ani Hashem Roficha. It says, why? When you come with these lackadaisical hands, Yadim Rofim, who do you need? You need a Rufay. The Rufay is the one that's going to take you back. He says, just come to me even like that and I'm going to be able to take care of you. Now, furthermore, what is a Jew supposed to do when he's being attacked by Amalek? You should know that Amalek lives inside of us. Amalek is also Gematria Safek. If you ever, first of all, let me explain to you that concept. It says that we have Yetzirah Tov and Yetzirah Ra. There are angels in the Shamayim, Sarim, that are Memunim on the 70 nations. So imagine, there's a table, just like the UN has 70 nations. There's a group of people over there. But let's just say like this. In the there's 70 nations, a core, regardless of one, there's fractions that came out of it, but there's a core 70 nations in the Shamayim. One of them is Amalek, one of them is Israel, and the other one is the rest of the nations. And what happens is all these 70 nations sit around the table and they have an angel that's representing them. And the angel decides, it's decided by the angel if that nation goes up or goes down. And we could see, for example, Venezuela's angel, he's down right now, right? You see what's going on in that country. You go to America, the angel is up. You see that they're very successful, doing very good. China's angel up, they're doing a tremendous amount of business. They have a lot of prosperity. The angels go up and down. So each one has an angel that represents them. Who represents Amalek in the Shamayim? Who's the angel that represents them? The Yetzer Hara, the devil himself. Who represents the Jewish nation? Which angel sits in the seat of Am Yisrael? Hashem. Hashem sits on that table. He's our representative. So we know that we have Yetzer HaTov and Yetzer HaRa inside of us. Yetzer HaRa is the representative of Amalek. So now what would you know? That we have Amalek inside of us. Now, because we have Amalek inside of us, how do we know when Amalek is taking over us? Amalek is the same gematria, same numerical value as Safek, doubt. Whenever you start to have doubt in your life, whenever you start to question yourself, your business, your relationship, your faith in God. Every time you start to have doubt, safek in your life, understand that the Amalek is now stronger in your body. The minute you have emunah, then you're on the Yetzer HaTov is winning. Listen to this. If your emunah is strong, the Yetzer HaTov. If you go and you say, tomorrow Hashem is providing to me. Today I have zero on my bank account. Tomorrow, Hashem Yirachem, it's going to be there. If you have safek, what happens? I have no money today. What's going to be tomorrow? The bills, this, that, that. Amalek is winning. Today, I don't have a zivug. Don't worry. Hashem is going to give me my zivug. Mm-hmm. When you have doubt, who am I going to meet? Where is she? My neighborhood, city, should I travel? Should I move? Anytime you have doubt in your life, Amalek is winning. But anytime then, you have emunah, Yetzer HaTov is winning.
But in life, you always have doubts. You know, business, this, that. You know?
Work on your emunah.
If you have a strong emunah, then...
Because you have to know, you have to live with one thing. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Hu Tov, Hu Metiv. Hashem, if you want to give him a label, he's good. And everything that he does is good. HaKol Letova, there's no... En Ra Yored La'olam, that's the Gemara says. There's no such thing as bad that comes down to the world. So what happens? Anytime something happens to you, you say, you know what? השתבח שמו לעד, it's for the best. I lost that sale, it's probably for the best. With my human eyes and this brain, I can't figure it out. But my emunah tells me it's for the best. If Hashem wants me to understand it with my human eyes and my human mind, he'll do it for me. But up until then, blind faith, na'aseh v'nishma'ak, Hashem, it's all for the best. Thank you very much.
There was a rabbi, his name Gamzu.
Gamzu l'tova, same concept. Continue. It says, give me another tip. Give me something that I can do when I'm in trouble. Give me something that I can do when I have doubt. Give me something that I can do when things are not going my way. Mm-hmm. Give me something that I can do when I chose the wrong path. I complained. I didn't do the right thing. Kasher yarim yado v'gavar Yisrael. You should know right here, right now, that the strongest power that a Jew has is his mouth. Not because we're great salesmen. Not because we can use this mouth to convince people to buy our product or to convince people to do things our way. Because we have the power to create and to change reality. And it all begins with prayer. 95% of the things that happen in your life are because of prayer. 5% is ishtadlut. That's how strong your tefillah needs to be. Kasher yarim yado, when the Jew picks up his hand, וגבר ישראל. That's how a Jew wins. So that means in the morning, you know how you start your day? You check yourself into a shul and you pray to Hashem. That's how you start the day. Because that's 95% of the success you have for the rest of the day. The rest is an email, a phone call, you walk here, you walk there. You understand? This is what this parasha is teaching us. Now, in conclusion, when one is ready to get out of their physical slavery, or mental slavery. And you should know that people right now are enslaved by their bodies. Whether it's for drugs, whether it's for food, whether it's for medications, whatever it is. Mentally enslaved. And physically enslaved. There's so many things that put people in a prison where they can't get out of it. The neshama is always going to be thirsting for one thing. Regardless of what your mentality and your physicality tell you, the neshama, the thing that runs this machine, is thirsting for one thing. That's knowledge and spirituality that comes by the way of the Torah. That's what it really wants. If you want, try it. Do an experiment with yourself. Go and teach, allow yourself to go through a little cycle, a 90-day cycle, where the only thing that you're feeding your neshama, Torah mitzvot ma'asim tovim. See what happens after one quarter. See what happens after 90 days. What is the result? Say, I am the test tube baby. I'm the one that, I want a rebirth of my spirituality. I'm going to try something for the next 90 days. I want to see what happens to me when I do Torah mitzvot ma'asim tovim for 90 days and get back to me. Because the Torah has that power. Because that's what we really thirst for. As soon as that Jew get out of Egypt, what he said, I'm thirsty. What did Moshe Rabbeinu put? He put the etz. Don't worry. Etz chayim and machzikim ba. The Torah is coming. It sweetens things up. If you don't do that, if you don't busy yourself with Torah mitzvot ma'asim tovim, understand that your Jewish life has a default setting, which means I do nothing in Judaism. You become neutral. Amalek says, that's my customer. The Yetzirah says, prime candidate. He's not even fighting me. He's allowing me. Guards are down.
Take over.
Now, the biggest power, like Munch said, is the prayer. It's a cycle. It's either a vicious cycle where you constantly get into a mess and you try everything, it doesn't work for you, and then you cry to Hashem. Or it's a cycle of life, where whatever comes, you're doing it through what the book says. Whatever comes is whatever Hashem says, and you understand it's all for the best. So you could have a life like this. Two scenarios. Two identical situations. Two guys, both had an accident. Both lost a business. Both got married. One is having hardships. They're both having the exact same thing. One guy has no Torah, The other guy has a Torah. The guy with no Torah will tell you, what's going on? I don't understand. Where's my luck? Everything that I touch turns into mush. I don't understand. How could this be? I'm having such a hard time with my wife, with the money, with the... What's going to be? Why? His life becomes hard. He starts to live with stress. He becomes a magnet to sicknesses. Lo alenu v'lo alechem. What is he? He gets into a situation, you know, that stress and anger, they cause diseases. He says, oh, no. Nothing can help me, not my wife, not my money. No, no, okay. Hashem, ani Hashem rofecha. Wait, I heard somewhere that ani Hashem rofecha. God is my doctor. And they turn to him. A vicious cycle. If you get there, you're all going to get to the same place. The other guy, whether he had an accident, he says, you know what? Oh, Hashem. Because why? Maybe if I would have driven for another hour, somewhere over there would have been something that's not good for me. Hashem put a stop sign in front of me. Plus, this friend, the bender, okay, kaparat avonot. Let me tell you, it better comes out in money than something else. I'm having a hard time with my zivug. I'm probably not ready. At the right time, Hashem will give it to me. Hashem, whenever you want to give me the blessing, I'm here. I'm a vessel. I'm leaving it open. You just, everything that you do, letovah, and Hashem wafecha. He comes to you. So it's either a cycle of life and you know how to live it and accept God, or a vicious cycle that eventually gets you to the same place. The machalot of Mitzrayim, and you need a rofe. Now, there's a story. There's a story of a guy that's walking in the desert. And all of a sudden he finds $100 bill. He looks left, he looks right, he sees nobody. He picks it up, he's happy. I got $100 bill. He looks at it, he turns it around, it's real. Oh, on the back, you know what it says? If you found this $100 bill on the exact same spot where you found it, dig 10 meters and you'll find $1,000. Said what? Starts to dig. Wouldn't you know it? He finds $10,000. I'm sorry, $1,000. He looks at it, he turns it over. He says, if you found this, if you dig another 5 meters, you'll find $100,000. What? He digs, $100,000. He gets over there, a big note. If you got this far, if you dig one more meter, there's $1,000,000. He digs. He's sitting over there. He's rich. He got. As soon as he's rich, he looks up. He's in a hole that he can't get out of. He dug himself so deep he can't get out. What does he say? He says, how am I going to get out of here? He starts yelling, help! Help! Help me! I need to get out, otherwise I'm going to die. What am I going to do here with $1,000,000? I can't do anything with it. Passes by some guy, a desert dweller, and he hears him. And he tells him, get him out. He goes, get you out. He says, I'll get you out for all the money that you have. And he says, I'll give you all my money, because if you don't get me out, I'm going to die. He takes him out of the hole and takes all his money. That's how it is in life sometimes. A person starts to obsess over money, over a career, over sports, over women, over all these vices that are already. He digs himself in such a big hole that he gets into trouble. And then after, what does he do? He says, I'll give anything to get out of this hole. I'll do anything to get out of this problem. And what does he find himself again? Back in square one. Why? Because it's a vicious cycle. That's why you want to take the cycle of life. That's the better cycle. Where you accept life and you move life. And once you're on that positive train of Na'aseh v'nishma, you start to activate the what? The formulas of success. If you listen to my Torah, if you listen to Mitzvot, if you listen to my Chukim, no machala is going to get you, ani Hashem rofecha. And there's many, many, many more guarantees for parnasa, for zivug, for etzlacha. They're all here, they're buried in the Pesukim. It all depends if you're going to be able to activate it. You should know that as we're starting Sefer Shemot, and we're in the story of the Jewish people, Moshe Rabbeinu in the desert, know this. Moshe Emet, V'Torato Emet. Moshe is Emet, his Torah is Emet. Get connected to the Emet. You will reap unbelievable dividends if you start to connect to it. It's not instant. This is not, we're the age of instant gratification. I said Shakoni Abidvaro, where's $1,000,000? I kept Shabbat, where's my Bentley? That doesn't work like that. You're gonna get tested. Hashem, I'm gonna try him to see if he's gonna go on my Torah. It takes time. You know who has the hardest time? Baalei Tshuva. Hashem says, hey listen, you have a bill over here. You owe me a whole lot for what you did over here. You want to go straight into a successful tzaddik? No. We have to erase some of the bill. How? Give you a little bit of hardships in Panasa, a little bit of hardships in Dubai, a little bit of hardships in this, a little bit of health. Why? It's for your best, don't worry. If not, you're going to have to pay for it in the other world. Over there, there's a Nahag Yehinnom of fire. He's trying to save you from that. He says, get rid of the debt here. When you go to eternal life, I can give you the best Olam Haba that's possible. That's the whole thing. We're here for a short period of time. We have eternal life. We live forever. Be'ezat Hashem, I see you in the next world, and the next world, and the next world, and the next world. Right here, we're just passing through. So understand, Moshe Emet, V'tu'ato Emet, get connected to the truth, and you'll see incredible Yeshuot. This week we learn, Ani Hashem Rofecha. Shabbat Shalom.